type of personality succeeds in business? In John Ronson's book, The Psychopath Test, he puts forward the idea that psychopaths, someone who lacks remorse or empathy, who lies at will, who manipulates others, may actually be pretty at home in the business world, which may be why CEOs tend to be psychopaths at about 4 times the rate of the general population. Ronson spends a good deal of time with people like Chainsaw Al Dunlap, who achieved fame and fortune by taking over companies, ruthlessly firing people, and selling the companies for billions of dollars. Does that mean that psychopaths are good for business? Well, Dunlap definitely turned around some companies that were big losers and then sold them for a lot more than they were originally worth. But inevitably, people figured out that he was engaging in massive accounting fraud. The first company he was president of, a paper mill in Niagara Falls, reported a profit of $5 million in 1976. It turned out that that was actually a $5.5 million loss. Dunlap didn't let a little fraud get in his way, though, as he moved on to other companies where he did similar things. He ended up being very successful and he died rich, but he nearly obliterated every business he touched. I'm thinking about all of this because of a new paper I just read out of UC Berkeley's Haas School of Business. Researcher Jennifer A. Chapman specializes in examining narcissism in the business world. Narcissists are different from psychopaths, but I think a person could be both if they try hard enough. Narcissists, by definition, think extremely highly of themselves and devalue the people around them, expecting constant praise and attention, while assuming that they're too good for things like apologies or rules or laws. There's a pervasive belief that in order to be successful in the business world, you need to have a bit of narcissism. You have to believe in yourself even when other people are telling you you're an idiot. Like Elon Musk might be a good example. Chapman looks into whether or not beliefs like that are true, and thus far it seems like her research is saying absolutely fucking not. Narcissists are, in fact, the worst. Previous studies have suggested that they are overpaid, and also they tend to get their companies involved in more lawsuits while not actually making the company any more money. I think things like that are generally looked down upon in the corporate world. I'm not too sure, though. They don't let me in the corporate world anymore. This most recent paper looked at how a narcissist can take over a company and completely change their culture. They did this by conducting 5 different tests. In the first study, they had 400 people from the Mechanical Turk take surveys to determine their level of narcissism and then ask how they feel about things like collaboration and integrity. They found that narcissists tended to look down on those traits. In the second study, they looked at 259 MBA students, presumably from UC Berkeley. Upon enrollment in the program, each of the students was asked to provide 3 or more references from former coworkers or other colleagues. The researchers contacted those references and basically tried to figure out from them how these students rated on narcissism. Then they asked the students themselves how they felt about organizational cultures. Sure enough, students who scored higher in narcissism were less likely to value collaboration and integrity in the workplace. For the third study, they contacted current employees at Fortune 1000 companies and they asked them about their CEOs. Again, CEOs that scored higher on narcissism seemed to have made a company culture that devalued collaboration and integrity. I say seemed to have made because they still, at this point, have only proved a correlation and not causation. So in their final 2 studies, they attempt to establish causation. In the 4th study, they went back to the Mechanical Turk and they asked subjects to rate how likely they were to perform certain actions that would make a workplace more or less collaborative or full of integrity. Narcissists were less likely to punish coworkers for a lack of integrity. They were more likely to promote someone with a lack of integrity, and they were more likely to support policies that would create a less collaborative workplace. And in the final study, 200 Mechanical Turk subjects were put into scenarios in which they had to report to a boss who was either more or less narcissistic. They were asked how likely they would be to recommend collaborative policies to that boss or report company violations to that boss. And what they found was that for subjects reporting to a narcissistic CEO in a work culture that was low on integrity and collaboration, the subjects were more likely to behave in low integrity, low collaboration ways. So what does all of this mean? Well, the researchers point out that a narcissistic CEO can really screw up the culture of a workplace by promoting unethical or amoral people, discouraging collaboration amongst employees, and ignoring violations of company policy. That, in turn, creates a sort of feedback loop where employees who would usually behave with integrity are suddenly convinced that there's no point in doing so. And in order to fit in and get ahead, they drop their integrity and collaborative spirit. Companies with cultures like that tend to not do very well. So eventually, the board may realize what's happening and fire the CEO. But at that point, it may be too late. The researchers point out that once the CEO is gone, the culture is going to persist unless and until someone actively tries to reverse the damage that the narcissist did. Look, this isn't a model study. The data is pretty messy, and conducting research on the Mechanical Turk and college students is never going to reveal exactly what is happening in the real world. But it is compelling, especially the specific study that surveyed actual employees at large companies. And now more than ever, I think it's critical to understand how a single narcissist in a leadership position doesn't just come in and screw things up in the short term until you, the board of directors votes him out. That single narcissist is likely enacting policies and promoting people who create a culture that is larger than him. It's not enough to just get rid of him if you want, say, a culture that values integrity and collaboration. Cleaning up his mess is going to take hard work, not just from the new president or CEO, but from everyone in the organization. Everyone needs to come together and say, I won't say it. I recently heard from a guy named Jamie Harrison who said something that sounds about right. So just listen to this.
The people running the Democratic Party today are nuts. They want to give illegal immigrants free health care and have open borders. That's not solving our immigration problem. They want socialized medicine. Medicare for all means Medicare for nobody. They want to take your health care away at the work site. They want to do with electoral college. They want to expand the Supreme Court beyond 9 justices to pack it with liberals. There's a lot at stake here.
Thank you, Mr. Harrison.
So the first step in terms of working with the other side is not to call the other side nuts. This is the thing, Senator Graham. I have a 6-year-old who I often teach in terms of how to conduct himself. And I said, son, that sometimes people come from different backgrounds and they see the world a little differently, but that doesn't make them bad because of it. Even though Democrats and Republicans may take the different paths, hopefully our destination is the same. How can we make South Carolina a better place for all of us, not just Democrats or Republicans or progressives versus conservatives or liberals and whatever other term you want to come up with? We're South Carolinians first. We're Americans first. How are we going to work together? When I was the chair of the South Carolina Democratic Party, my best friend in politics was the Republican chair, Matt Moore. And Matt and I think there was even a story written about how we were the odd couple because we worked together. We respected each other. And that's the foundation for how you get things done. You've been in Washington for 25 years. Yes, you listed climate change and immigration. Those are issues that still have not been addressed. You've only passed 3 bills, 3 laws that you sponsored originally in 25 years. We can do better, but we got to change the leadership to do so.
Thank you.